Warm welcome. So first meetup after summer, and this time a technical meetup. So I hope you guys are well prepared for all the tech stuff, what we're going to hear. But before I get into details, anybody here first time? Yes, a couple of guys. So I do this kind of very short intro before we go on to our main talk today. So you're here in the Blockchain Hub Meetup, which is organized by Blockchain Hub Graz. We are a network of blockchain hubs. Lately, even more decentralized as it was like a year ago, because basically everybody is doing his own stuff and the market is so much changing that the most active blockchain hub is probably Graz. So this is like we are keeping up the flag on blockchain hubs. But due to all this kind of history, we have quite nice connections to various people from various places, be it in Brussels or in Berlin or some other places like Oslo and so on, or Bulgaria and Sofia. So it's rather easy to get some information. The crypto space was 2016 not as big as it is right now. So when we started with the blockchain hubs in 2016, it was basically three hubs, and you knew everybody, and therefore we started kind of discussing, okay, what is blockchain? And so therefore we said, well, we are a non-profit organization. We translate blockchain to non-techies and we kind of connect people with each other. What we still do more individually than a couple of years ago. But I think all the hype, what we have seen 2017 kind of changed a bit the whole scene. Just to make it clear, when we 2016, when we did the blockchain startup contest, we reached out to blockchain startups on a global scale. So we got 80 applications from 5 continents. So really, we went global with trying to reach everybody who is doing something, some project in blockchain space. And then we had like 20 pitching at the final event. And during that pitches, we selected 5 winners, 2 basically main winners, which you probably know if you're in the Ethereum ecospace. The one is Status, which is currently developing an instant messaging app for Ethereum, the instant messaging app for Ethereum, and a lot of other things. So they collected, I don't know, 150 million during the ICO or something. So that was when they did their ICO. It was completely uninteresting what you actually put into the paper. One said to me that the most interesting use case for their coin was using it for emojis in their app. So it really didn't matter for them. But half a year earlier, they applied for our contest. And that contest, they got 5,000 euros in ETH. So of course it was 10 euros at that moment. And so therefore it was a lot more half a year later, but nevertheless, it was a completely different kind of environment at that time. The second one was EtherRisk. I think EtherRisk did an ICO or just lately, recently. Month ago or something. Do you know any outcome?
3 million or something.
3 million?
Yeah.
Oh, that's disappointing.
If they did it last year, they would have raised 100 million.
Yeah, if they would have done it last year, they definitely would have raised a lot. And just imagine that they are intending to build an insurance business. For insurance, you need quite a lot more money than 3 million to get it going. So. Well, those were the two which applied. Both are well known in the Ethereum ecosystem and were one of those few actually known in the space at that time. If you're a beginner, which I don't hope, so We have had a couple of stuff put out at the Wirtschaftskammer where you can get familiarized with some topics on basics of blockchain. There is a repository or is a YouTube channel where you can look up some videos, also the video which is done today, so you will be able to watch that again. So if you kind of can't follow Ralph, watch the video again and get behind what he's talking about. Slides will be put on SlideShare. Do we get your slides?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Then we put them on SlideShare as well, so you can look them up, so you don't have to take pictures from the slides today. So we're already here at the main act. So Ralph will talk about Constantinople and the state of state channels. So which is, so if you don't know, Constantinople is the long-awaited second part of a hard fork, bringing a couple of changes for Ethereum. And if you don't know Ralph, that's something you should definitely look up again. So basically, Ralph is the Pope of Ethereum in Austria, so a localized Pope. So as you've in the previous times had several popes, so he's one for Ethereum in Austria. And he's running the meetup for Ethereum Vienna. Does a lot of education stuff, so how to program in Solidity and so on. So he has complete program build up there. So if you want to get into details, he's the right source to go to. So he can be found in the RIAD, which is a hackerspace in Vienna, with a lot of different kind of people in different coins specialized. So you have NEM there, you have Dogecoin there, you have Ethereum there, and I don't know what else, but Monero, yes, of course, Monero as well. And so you find there really knowledgeable people in that space, and Ralph is one of those, and I'm looking forward to his talk. So thank you for coming. So. Please.
Okay. Welcome everybody from my side. Today we're going to talk about Constantinople, the upcoming hard fork, very briefly, and then we move to our main topic, which will be state channels and what exists, where are we, and what actually works at the moment. So this is a presentation I already did once 3 weeks ago in Vienna. I updated it a bit, but of course 3 weeks is a long time in Ethereum, so some things might be outdated, but I've tried to update as much as possible. Yeah. So let's dive into the first topic, which is Constantinople. Now, Constantinople is a hard fork. It's going to be the next hard fork for Ethereum. Thomas already said, it's the second part of the Metropolis upgrade. The changes were already supposed to happen like a year ago, but then it got split. But now it's finally happening. And this is coming pretty soon. So it's coming to Robson October 9th. That's not much away, so Robson is a testnet for Ethereum, and that will be tested for a few weeks, and then sometime in November it will be released to mainnet. They say early November, I don't believe it, it's probably going to be end of November. So what does Constantinople actually give us? It has several ERPs, and an ERP is an Ethereum improvement proposal. It's basically how the protocol changes. Somebody writes a proposal, which is a standardized structure that says what are the changes, what is the rationale, and then they go through various phases and eventually they get accepted. And so several ERPs were accepted for Constantinople. The first one, which is probably the most irrelevant one, is ERP 145, which will bring some bitwise shifting operations into the EVM. It can bring some minor optimizations, but it won't really change anything. Maybe it saves a minimum amount of gas, but it won't really make a big difference. A much bigger difference will be this ERP 1014, which is called Grade 2, or quite often also called Skinny Grade 2. And this is a new variation of the Grade opcode, and the Grade opcode is basically what a contract can use if a contract itself wants to deploy another contract. And what this ERP does is it introduces a way to create a contract where a newly created contract gets an address that you can already predict beforehand. Because normally in Ethereum, whenever you create a contract, it needs to get assigned an address. And the way this works is that the address is basically a hash over the sender, the deployer of the contract, as well as a nonce, which keeps increasing every time the sender does something or deploys something. And this leads to unpredictable contract addresses. And that is bad for state channels. And we will see in our state channels part why we need skinny grade 2. Also interesting is the EAP 1052, which introduces also a new opcode called the Xcode hash opcode. And what this does is it makes checking whether a contract has a code that you expect a lot cheaper. So sometimes you interact with a contract at some address and you don't know beforehand if this is really the contract you expect. And you don't want to interact with a false contract which might try to attack you, for example. And so what you do, if you only have an address and you need to make sure that it's a contract that you know in terms of code, you can copy basically the code into your own memory of the other contract and check that it's what you're expecting. But this is quite expensive because you need to copy the entire code of the other contract into your own memory. And we don't really need this because the only thing we really care about is a fingerprint for this contract. And now we're getting an opcode which basically gives us this fingerprint for the code of this contract without actually having to copy it. And this can make this check a lot cheaper than it is right now. Probably one of the biggest differences though for the end user is EAP 1283, which is called Net Gas Metering for S2 without dirty maps. And while it has a complicated name, it's actually, the idea is quite simple. It makes writes to storage a lot cheaper if they were already written within the same transaction previously. So right now, whenever you update something in storage on the Ethereum blockchain, like say a token balance, you always pay at least 5,000 gas for every word that you write into storage. And that's true even if you write to a field and then you immediately write to it again, then you still pay 5,000. And the reason why you pay so much is because in Ethereum, everything is organized in this Merkle tree structure. And basically, whenever you update a storage field that has a lot of hash functions that need to be executed in the background, and that it produces a lot of cost. But you only really need to do this operation at the end of the transaction. And so whether you change it only once or whether you change it 10 times, it doesn't really make a lot of difference. And so with this new gas metering, basically the first write is still going to cost 5,000 because it's an expensive operation. But then if you change it again within the same transaction, it will only cost, say, 200 gas and no longer 5,000. And this could really drastically change the gas cost of some contracts. For example, if you have something where you need to, within a transaction you route, say an EC20 token to one address, and then it gets forwarded to yet another address, the balance of the account in the middle doesn't actually change, but you still pay for every write in between, even though it has the same value at the end. And with this new thing, you wouldn't pay for it anymore. You still pay for it, but it's a lot less than previously. So this might really make a lot of things a lot cheaper than they are right now, which makes it probably the most significant of the changes. Then we have the most controversial of the EAPs, which is EAP 1234. And that's probably the reason why it was chosen over all the competitors, just because it was the nicest number. And what it does is it delays the difficulty bump, and the controversial part, it also reduces the block reward to 2 Ether. So right now the block reward is still 3 Ether per block, and starting with Constantinople it will be only 2 Ether. Of course, a lot of people oppose this, a lot of miners oppose this, and a lot of people also oppose this because they think that it's, now with the ETH ASICs and everything, it pushes Ethereum even more into the ASICs. But yeah, other than the adjustment, it delays the difficulty bump by another 12 months, which means in a year we will have the same situation yet again, and we will have to have another hard fork to delay the bump. Internally, it uses the same fake block number mechanism as the last.
Deliver proof of stake, not delay bomb.
What?
Deliver proof of stake, not delay bomb.
Yeah, that was the idea, but it's never ready. And yeah, that's 1234. Unfortunately, EAP 1218 was delayed yet again. It's one of those APs. It's always included in the next hard fork, and then they drop it at the last minute. And yeah. So it's not in there. Yeah, and this is basically Constantinople and coming sometime in November. Now, one of the ERPs, as I already mentioned, was quite important for state channels. And this is what we're going to talk about now for the main topic. So first, to get started, we'll look at simple payment channels to get an easy intro into the whole thing. Then we will look at state channels and primarily at counterfactual instantiation in state channels, which is the most complicated of the topics. And afterwards, because we mostly focus on implementation by a company called Counterfactual, we will also briefly discuss alternate implementations that also are in the works. So let's talk about payment channels first. Now, what's the problem that we really have? Blockchains don't scale very well. They scale really, really badly. You have fees that are incurred on every state update. So whenever you make even the smallest payment, you have to pay your fees. You don't have instant finality. And what I mean by this is when you send a transaction, you don't know if it's really going to get included or if there's some competing transaction that will get included. So we need to wait for a time until you have some reasonable expectation that this transaction will really make it into the blockchain. And another problem is, of course, privacy. If everything is on-chain, everybody can see every individual payment of everybody else. And that's also not the most desirable thing. Now, luckily, there is a solution. And of course, it's a solution with a lot of drawbacks as well, but it can solve some of the issues. Most of the payments can be moved off-chain if, and those are assumptions we have to make, they happen between a closed set of participants, which means we cannot use this kind of technology. If you have like an open set of participants where people all join all the time and leave all the time. And also, we must assume that transactions can be included into the blockchain within the time frame, within a certain time limit. And if one of those two assumptions is not true, we cannot use channel technology and we need to fall back to something else like Plasma or something some other thing that's in development. Yeah. And basically, if we have those two things, then we can use the blockchain only for settlement and the dispute resolution. Now, let's look at the simplest possible example, which is just a very simple unidirectional payment channel. So here we have an example where we have Alice and we have some server S on the right side. And Alice needs to send many small payments and it should all be instantaneous. One example would be some streaming service where I pay for every 100 milliseconds of stream or whatever. Of course, it cannot send the transaction every 100 milliseconds because it would pay more in fees than the actual payment. Now, in this example, there's no need for the money to go the other way because the server won't ever send anything back to Alice. So we can have a simple unidirectional channel. And the way this works is basically Alice creates a channel in the beginning, and the channel is basically a contract on the blockchain that's deployed when you open the channel. And then Alice locks up 5 Ether into this channel, so the Ether are now transferred still on chain into the contract. This can of course happen at deployment time, so it's still only one transaction. Now Alice signs some structure, I call it the promise here, where it says the server should be able to retrieve 1 Ether. Nothing is actually changed on chain, but there is now this promise, which is signed by Alice's private key, that the server should be able to withdraw 1 Ether. Now, instead of making a blockchain transaction, Alice sends this promise to the server, and now the server knows, if necessary, the server can submit this promise to the channel and the channel will pay out the 1 Ether. So this is only one payment, but let's say Alice wants to send another Ether. So Alice now updates this. Basically, a new structure is signed, which now contains 2 Ether. Now, of course, the server now has 2 promises, but the idea is that in the unidirectional setting, he can only ever redeem 1, and so he's obviously going to pick the higher one of the 2. Now, when the server wants to cash out, this can be after 2 transactions like here, but if it's only 2 transactions, it's not really worth the whole setup. But if it's like 2,000 transactions, you've really saved a lot of money. And so the server can now cash out by submitting this promise to the channel contract. The channel contract sees this, knows the server will retrieve 2. So 2 should go to the server, 3 should go to Alice. And when the channel is closed, the funds are distributed. And so we have a constant number of on-chain transactions, regardless of how many off-chain transactions took place. Now, of course, we also need to implement some kind of channel timeout because otherwise we had the problem, what if the server never sends anything to the contract, the money would just be stuck. So there needs to be some timeout after which Elias can just withdraw everything again. Now, bidirectional channels are a bit more sophisticated because in the unidirectional channel, we can make the great assumption that it's in the server's best interest to use the latest promise because the value only ever increases. And if the server chooses to submit an earlier promise than the latest one, then it's good for Alice because Alice gets more money and the server loses. But in the bidirectional payment channel case, we don't have this luxury. We cannot assume this because the server might very well be interested in submitting an earlier version of the promise. Yeah, so bidirectional payment channels can use a nonce to find the latest promise. So a nonce is just a number that's supposed to increase on every state update. There's also a different approach to bidirectional payment channels, and that's using two unidirectional channels, which are then basically settled against each other at the end. This is the approach that the Raiden network used to use in the past, but in the last few months they also switched over to the nonce-based model because it makes a lot of other things a lot easier. So what's the core idea between the nonce-based model? Basically, all funds are held in a multisig-like contract, and all parties together sign and share updated states off-chain. And this implies that every update requires unanimous consent. You cannot move forward with any payment if not every single participant within the channel agrees to it. And in all implementations right now, this is always two people. There is no real implementation of a multi-people channel construction with more than two people. Even though it's possible in theory, but all the prototypes are always for two people. Yeah, so the state in this case, when I say state update, is basically the distribution of the assets in the channel. So who has how much? And because it's a nonce-based setup, the state also includes an increasing nonce. And we need this to detect stale states, which are just states that have been succeeded by a newer one. Now, when a channel needs to be closed, so when the off-chain part is over and we need to get back to the on-chain part, any party in the channel can submit the latest state. And the contract knows that it's a valid state because everybody has signed it and there's signature from everybody for the latest state. Now, the channel cannot know whether this is really the latest state because it might just be an earlier state that was submitted to the channel instead. And this means that the funds cannot be released immediately. And so you need to have a timeout so that the other parties can present counter evidence that there was, in fact, a later version of the state that was also agreed upon by everybody. And those later versions can be detected because of the nonce. Because you increase the nonce every time, you know that if there is another state which is also signed by everybody and it has a higher nonce than the other one, then the other one was not the latest state. Let's look at an example here. This time we have Bob and Alice, and they want to interact with a bidirectional payment channel. So any one of the two deploys a channel contract, and it has here the owners Bob and Alice, and it means that each of those promises needs to be signed by both Bob and Alice to be valid. Now, unlike the previous case where Alice just in the beginning submits 5 Ether into the contract, we can't really do this here because there needs to be a way in the contract for Bob to actually get back the 5 Ether in case Alice just disappears immediately. And so in the beginning, both sign a message that would allow Bob to withdraw 5 Ether. And because it's the first message, it has non-zero, Bob has a balance of 5 and Alice has a balance of 0, and it is of course signed by both parties. Now, knowing that this exists and it has been signed by both parties, it's now safe for Bob to deposit the 5 Ether because he knows that even should Alice disappear, he can just use this version, submit it to the contract, and get back the 5 Ether. So there's no risk for Bob here. Except, of course, timing. The Ether will get stuck for a while before because there needs to be the timer period, but he will get it back eventually. Now, Alice also needs to deposit something because we want to for the money to be able to move in both directions. And now we sign a new message, which will allow Bob to withdraw 5 Ether and Alias to withdraw the rest. And with rest, it means everything above 5 Ether. And the reason why we here saw a rest rather than the value that Alias wants to deposit is that if they now sign the version where it says Bob 5 and Alias 2, then there's now this version, and Alias doesn't deposit anything, he just sends the nonce 2 state update into the channel, steals 2 Ether, and then there's not enough left to Bob, and this is why we have this construction with withdraw the rest instead of withdraw some fixed amount. Now the nonce is of course 1 because it's a new state update, and 1 is the number after 0. So Alias can now deposit 1 Ether, knowing they can be retrieved again, because there's the rest of 6 minus 5 is 1. And so he will get the right amount back. Now that the Ether is in there, they can actually update again and remove this rest component. They sign a new message, Bob can withdraw 5 Ether, Alias can withdraw 1 Ether, the nonce is 2. And now we got rid of this rest thing, which we want to get rid of because it can cause problems for other operations. And we only need it immediately before the deposit and not after the deposit. So let's say we actually want to do something and Bob wants to pay Alice 1 Ether. So we make a new state update, the nonce is now 3. The balance of Bob has decreased by 1, and the balance of Alice has increased by 1. Let's see, there's another payment from Bob, an Ether again. So now the nonce is 4, the balance of Bob is 3, the balance of Alice is also 3. And yeah. But of course, there's also still the two other older states lying around on the nodes, and they could try to use this to attack the channel. But we will see what happens if they do. Now, let's say Alice wants to close the channel because the interaction with Bob is over and they want to retrieve their Ether. The latest state now gets submitted to the contract, and then a timeout begins. Now, some implementations also support instant withdrawal. It is possible to implement this, and some of the more sophisticated payment channels have this also, where I don't need to have necessarily a timeout if it is really a cooperative closing of the channel. But in this version, we don't have this, so Alice uses the last state update and puts it into the contract, which was this nonce for state update where Bob should get 3 Ether and Alice should also get 3 Ether. Now after the timeout expires, the deposit can be withdrawn, and so everybody gets exactly the amount they expected. And the channel is now closed, and if you need to have new interaction, you would create a new channel between the two parties. Let's say Alice is evil. Here it says Bob wants to close the channel, but actually Alice is going to do it. So in this case, a state with nonce 3 gets submitted, which is this older version of the state. And, oh no, of course Bob wants to close the channel in an evil way. So Bob wants to close the channel with this update here, which is the nonce 3 update, because he has 1 Ether more than in this version. And so he's incentivized to use the old version to get more money. And now, just like previously, a timeout begins. But, of course, because we're now in a timeout, Alice cannot present the state with nonce 4. And because 4 is larger than 3, the contract will recognize this is a later state update, and that will update its own internal state accordingly. So that is now also 3-3, just like in the previous example. So it's still, even though Bob tried to cheat, it's still the correct payout at the end. Now, in many implementations, Bob would be penalized, for example, if you submit a stale state. But in this particular scenario, we actually cannot penalize Bob because we cannot differentiate between the scenario where Bob attempted to cheat, like here, and the scenario where Alice refused to sign state number 4 after Bob already signed it. Now, with ECDSA, you cannot simultaneously sign something. Somebody always has to sign it first. And this gives Alice this will give Alice a way to attack Bob if we were to penalize Bob here. So basically, let's say they both create the number 4 state update. Bob signs it already, sends it to Alice. Alice does not sign it, so Bob has no choice but to actually use the nonce 3 state update, because it's the last state update that was signed by everybody. So to get his money back, he has to put the nonce 3 state update into the contract. But now Alice still has the nonce 4 update already signed by Bob. And so after Bob already has Bob has already submitted the channel, Alice now signs the nonce 4 state update, submits it as evidence into the channel contract, which cannot know that it was signed afterwards. And then if we now penalize Bob, basically, Bob was not guilty, but he was penalized anyway, which is why we cannot penalize Bob in this scenario, and we just have to let it pass. Now, this is safe if the difference in nonce is more than 1, but if the nonce is only different by exactly 1, then we cannot penalize because of this. Yeah, and just like in the previous example, once the timeout expires, the deposit can then be withdrawn, everybody gets the free Ether, and the channel is closed. Now, payment channels are nothing new. They're really old already. They started with Bitcoin, although in a less sophisticated manner. The most famous examples of those are, of course, the Lightning Network from Bitcoin and the Raiden Network in Ethereum, both of which are kind of in some, well, I guess Lightning is more in production. Raiden is still on testnet. And these projects more than just the payment channels. They also attempt to link different channels to a network, so you can interact between parties that don't have a common payment channel. And this kind of networking, there are also similar ideas that exist for state channel networks, which we will see a bit later. So those are payment channels, and payment channels are basically the beginning, and then somebody once one day realized we can also tellerize this to an arbitrary state rather than just payments, and this is where state channels come from. State channels operate very similar to payment channels. The basic ideas are you have various assets, which we call the state deposit, which are held in a multisig, and which is often called the state deposit holder, because it's the contract that actually owns all the assets while the channel exists. And just like in the payment channel example, the idea is to always sign the latest state off-chain, and then only escalate to the chain in case of a dispute, or if you want to close the channel at the end. Yeah. Similar to payment channels, we can also have some cooperative withdrawal scheme where we can get rid of the timeout. And there are even payment channel constructions where I can, or state channel constructions where I can withdraw something while leaving the channel open. Now, one company that is using this basically in production is Funfair. Unfortunately, the technology is proprietary, so the contracts aren't actually open source, but which is bad, but it was the first payment channel, first state channel in production. And they are using their construction, which is called Fate Channels, for gameplay, basically. So they are kind of like an online casino. It uses for gameplay, which wouldn't be feasible on-chain, and random number generation, which is impossible on-chain, unless with really complex cryptographic things, which are completely unproven. And so, through the use of those off-chain structures, they can still get pretty good security and do those things at low cost and with proper randomness. And basically, the way they do it is they have a channel between the player and the game server when the game begins. And one interesting thing is actually that the game logic that handles the entire game logic is actually a contract on the chain. And the computation is still happening off-chain in the channel, but basically the channel is doing like a virtual computation with the contract code, but only simulating it. But the code itself is still on the blockchain. And because the code itself is on the blockchain, in case of a dispute, the result of an action can be verified on-chain. Basically, the step where the dispute happens is replayed on-chain, now really with the whole consensus of Ethereum behind it. And that way, the user can always be guaranteed that the game server won't cheat, because if the game server would cheat for some reason, he can escalate to the chain and complete the game there in a safe manner. One interesting thing about Fanfare, which sets it apart from basically every other state channel project, is that Fanfare is really keen on short-lived channels that end after every game session. So you play a couple of games, and when your session is over, you close the channel, which is quite different from the normal approach, where I want to have a channel as long open as possible. But here they really want short-lived channels. Now, Fanfare is one of the few things where we actually have something that's more advanced than a payment channel and that's actually in production. Everything else is pretty much proof of concepts. Now, before we dive deeper into state channels, first we need to cover what are actually the requirements. When can you use state channels? Because the domain in which you can use state channels is actually quite restricted. So there are a number of requirements to hold. Just like in payment channels, you need to have a closed set of participants. That's because every state update, every participant needs to sign every state update. And that only works if you have a closed group where I know who everybody is in advance. It needs to be possible to have a transaction included within the timeouts. And this was important for the cheating scenario, because in case Alice was not able to present the counter evidence, Bob would have been able to cheat the channel. And so we need to make sure that the transaction can actually get into the chain in time. And this can be a problem in theory, because as you know, probably the Ethereum chain has been at capacity for like a year at least. But luckily for now at least, if you have a high enough gas price, you can still get in pretty quickly, in case you really need to get in quickly. But of course, if everybody does this, then this also won't work at some point. It also has to make economic sense to actually do disputes. And what I mean with this is, the disputes of course cost something. You all have to pay transaction fees. And if, say, your deposit in your state channel is, say, one crypto kitty, which is worth $10, but your transaction fee for the dispute would be $11, then it doesn't really make sense. And so you wouldn't even attempt to dispute it, even if you get cheated, because you would try to just accept that you lost it and minimize the losses. So you also need to make sure that disputes don't cost much. And if this is impossible, then these state channels are also not the right thing. Now, because everybody needs to sign every state update, this also means that all participants need to be online for every action, because the state channel cannot progress if even one of the signatures, if even one of the signers is not available, because you cannot get a new fully signed state update. And if somebody is offline, then attend stalls, and you have to wait until everybody is online again, or close the channel using the latest state update. Now, because we have this timeout scenario, every participant also needs to be online frequently enough to actually check for stale submits, because if you don't know that the counterparty is cheating you, you won't submit it in time, and then you lose your money. So this is also a requirement for every participant. Now, you can build constructions where you can basically submit the latest state to some third party which watches the blockchain for you and submits it on their behalf if there is a fraud attempt. But of course, this is also not without issues, because you need to incentivize this party not to collude with your opponent, but to actually submit the latest state in case of fraud. So that's also a complete not an easy thing. And finally, participants must not lose information about the latest signed states. And this is also something very critical, and it means you really need to make sure that you can never possibly lose information about what you signed. Because let's say you have a payment channel, you interact with some other party, you have this non-space construction, and then suddenly your node crashes, and its memory is gone. And so let's say it didn't backup everything yet, or let's say the computer itself exploded and everything is gone. So, and now you've lost like the last 10 state updates. And so your latest state update that you have is nonce minus 10, the current nonce minus 10. And the worst case is you might not even know that there were actually transactions afterwards. And so the only way for you to get money back now is either to convince your counterparty to send you the latest state update, and believes that it isn't like the latest one, or you submit your latest state update. But your latest state update now is not the real latest state update, because the real latest state update got lost during the crash. And so now you submit a stale state in accident because you don't know that it's a stale state. And now the counterparty submits the evidence that there was a later state, you get penalized and you lose everything. So that's also a big problem here, which is why you can never lose information about signed states. Okay, so those are very simple payment state channels, but the really interesting part is when you get to counterfactual state channels. But before we get to this, we first need to define some terminology, and by terminology I mean one word, and this is counterfactual. And basically, if I say some action X, then counterfactual X means that X could happen on the chain, but it doesn't. Any participant could unilaterally make X happen on chain, if necessary. And because of this, all participants can act as if X happened, because we know should the worst come to pass and we actually need to dispute on chain, we know that X will come true and will have happened in retrospect. Now, and the purpose of state channel is basically to do all actions, or at least as many actions as possible, counterfactually. So basically, like if, for example, in the payment channel example, every payment was a counterfactual payment because it could have happened on chain, but it doesn't unless there's dispute at some point. Any participant could make the transfer happen on chain by submitting the state to close the channel. And because this, all participants can always act as if the payment already happened. And yeah, this is our simple payment channels, but the real thing is, when everything gets a lot more complicated, is when you get to a counterfactual instantiation. And what I mean by this is, when we counterfactually instantiate a contract, what we mean is, instead of actually deploying the contract, we only sign a commitment, which could deploy the contract if we ever would need it, but it doesn't actually. So we counterfactually deploy it. And the contract will only ever actually get deployed in case of a dispute, and never if there is no dispute at all. And one of the reasons why this is great is because once the contract is deployed, or counterfactually deployed, the state deposit holder, which is the multisig, can basically delegate call into the contract, and this means we execute within our multisig the code of another contract, which is the contract that will eventually get counterfactually deployed. And this means we can change the state channel resolution code arbitrarily after the channel has already been opened, and we can do it completely off-chain. And this makes a very powerful construction, because now we can install new applications into an existing state channel, we can uninstall applications from an existing state channel, we can have many applications simultaneously in the state channel, and it really allows a lot of useful things. Now, there is one problem, and the big problem is that contract addresses, as I mentioned in the beginning, depend on the deployer and its nonce. And once you have multiple contracts that are all counterfactually instantiated, and they need to interact with each other on chain in case of the dispute, you get the problem that the contracts can't really know which address they will have once they get really deployed, because we don't have this deterministic address. And so presently, all the state channel systems that exist and that use counterfactual instantiation basically use a global registry contract, and all counterfactual contracts get deployed through this registry contract. The registry contract now assigns a counterfactual address, which is not a normal Ethereum address, but a special address format, which is not dependent on the nonce, but only on the contract code and its constructor arguments. And then other components, instead of having some address hard-coded in them, they basically look up the real address during the dispute, and that way they can still communicate when the actual on-chain dispute happens. Now Skinny Grade 2, which is coming in Constantinople, we'll solve this problem with this new Grade 2 opcode, which will give us deterministic addresses that do not depend on the nonce, and then the registry can probably be removed. But for now, it's still necessary. Now, the next thing one can realize is that because we can now counterfactually instantiate arbitrary code, we can also counterfactually instantiate the dispute resolution mechanism. And what follows from this is that the only thing that you actually need to deploy ever on chain, if there's no dispute, is a simple multi-sig contract without any state channel functionality. And this is actually really great because now you have just a normal multi-sig contract, nobody even knows that there is a state channel. Because the state channel itself is not counterfactual. And so, yeah, a simple multi-sig. The basic requirements, this is not a complete list, but you basically need a unanimous consent multi-sig, so you can't have one of those multi-sigs where you have like two out of three or something. It needs to be really n out of n, always. And you will also have to need support delegate call, or at least normal call with call data. And this simple multi-sig is basically the approach that Counterfactual is taking. So Counterfactual is a company which is in part funded by this L4 thing. I'm not sure what the correct legal relation is between the two, but for most intents and purposes, they're the same thing. And from now on, whenever I say something about state channel, I mean L4 state channel. There are different state channel implementations, but everything I say from now on is always about the L4 state channel. And in this L4 model, basically a state channel consists of many small counterfactual objects. And those are basically counterfactually instantiated contracts. They all have their own nonces, and they can finalize depending on other counterfactual objects. And what I mean by finalize here is that basically we say this contract cannot actually, even if everything is signed, we say the state of it cannot actually finalize unless, for example, this other counterfactual object is also already finalized. And finalized means that it has been deployed, the timeout for the dispute has already expired, and all the dependencies were also met. And here we see an example of what could exist in a channel. So we have two objects. We have this object A and the object B. This one is just a nonce object. It's really only a very simple object. The only thing it has really is a nonce. And we have a payment channel, which in this case here does not have a nonce, but normally we would also have one. And the idea is that the payment channel object depends on the nonce object. And so it can only finalize if the nonce object finalizes, and it finalizes at nonce number 3. What if we want to update our state channel and we remove the payment channel because we have finished with it and we no longer need the payment channel? Then we can just issue a new version of our nonce object, now with nonce number 4. And because the payment channels requires that the object A finalizes with nonce number 3, it is now invalid and can no longer finalize. And so basically, our payment channel was erased from our state channel. Now we can also have multiple counterfactual objects, of course, that all also look at the same other object. So for example, here we have, in addition to the payment channel and the chess, also the chess game, which is also dependent on the A object with nonce number 3. And here we also see that both the B and the C object have their own nonces. And that way we can now make different kind of updates. So we could, for example, update the payment channel by just issuing a new payment channel object with nonce number 9. And we don't need to touch this or the chess game. So this can happen completely independent of the other components. We could update the chess game independently by just issuing a new C object with nonce number 4. And we could delete both of them by issuing a new nonce object with nonce number 4, in which case both those things would go invalid and we've deleted both of them. Now, this dependency mechanism allows for atomic state transitions. So in the example here on the right side, we basically have a payment channel and then we get a poker game. And the idea is we now want to create the poker game. And we, at the same moment where we create the poker game, we need to decrease the balances of the payment channel. And so in the beginning, we only have our payment channel with balances 5 and 5. And now we want to instantiate this poker object. So we create the poker object where we say the winner will get 2 ether. And it depends on the A object, but with nonce number 4. So it's not valid yet because there is no A object with nonce number 4 yet. But of course, because we want to put one Ether from each player into the poker object, so it's actually solvent and can actually pay the winner at the end, we need to reduce both the balances in the payment channel by one. So we create a new payment channel object, now with balances 4 and 4 instead of 5 and 5. And it also depends on non-summer 4. Which, and so it's also still not able to finalize because there is no non-number 4 object. But now, once we have both of those things, we can now create the non-number 4 object. And as a consequence, those two things now simultaneously become valid and finalizable. At the same time, the old payment channel with the higher balances, because it depended on non-number 3, can no longer finalize because the check is now broken. And so we atomically switch over from one payment channel object to two objects. And yeah, we know it, and we know we cannot end the scenario where we have the poker game and the old state. Now, this is a very simple example, but of course you can have multiple applications in theory in such a state channel. So the idea is that there's going to be some root nonce object, and basically the whole point of the root nonce object is so that you're able to just delete everything by just updating a single object in case you need it. And here we see some examples that could also be implemented. So here we have an Ether conditional payment, and this is a different error here, and the idea is there's a class object, but this is not a dependency. Instead, the conditional payment observes the class object, and it basically observes the state of the game. And once the game has finished and you've won, you get the payment. You can also do this to implement atomic swaps. So you would have an atomic swap object that would be set up first. Then you make the two conditional payments that pay the two tokens, which both monitor this swap object. Then you update the swap object, and atomically both of those will change the behavior and the swap happens. Then we have another condition payment, which here observes a payment channel. And of course, a counterfactual object can also observe an on-chain contract. So for example here, this conditional payment observes an on-chain oracle that says the result of the US presidential election 2020, so it's basically betting on the outcome. This could, for example, be the Augur contract, and that's interfacing with this. So it can also observe, of course, every on-chain contract if necessary, because it is arbitrary code that can be deployed here. Now, as I said earlier, those channels can also be in theory be linked together, similar to how you link payment channels to like Lightning Network or Raiden. And one concept that's not implemented, that's only theory, is this. So here we have a channel between Alice and Ingrid, and we have a channel between Ingrid and Bob. But Alice wants to send a payment to Bob, but they don't have a direct channel. But they still want to do it off-chain. And so the idea now is that in each channel, they create a proxy payment channel. And both of those proxy payment channels observe the same counterfactual object, which is outside of both of the channels, but it's still a counterfactual object. But they know that if somebody were to try to cheat, they could still deploy this counterfactual object, and then both of those state channels would update simultaneously because the observation now leads to the payment. And of course, this can be more than just two channels. So here we route from Alice to Bob over three channels in between, and the idea is in every channel you have the proxy payment channel object, and it always observes this Alice Bob payment counterfactual object, which exists outside of any channel and is observed by all of the inside proxy payment channels. Yeah, so this is only theory, there's no implementation of this, and this will definitely require a lot more research before one can check whether this is actually a safe construction. So let's look at the actual actions that happen when you instantiate, for example, something. So this is how we would counterfactually actually deploy a contract. So we have this registry, and the registry is the thing that deploys every contract because we need the mapping from counterfactual address to real Ethereum address. And it needs to be deployed through the multisig. And so what's actually signed here is a commitment for the multisig that can be supplied to the multisig if necessary. And basically the commitment says to the multisig, call the registry contract with this call data, which is deploy and the bytecode of the object. So now we get a commitment and we know we can use this commitment, submit it to the multisig, and it will counterfactually deploy the contract if necessary. And we do this for every contract that we need in case of a dispute. Now ideally, of course, there is no dispute, and we never need to actually do it, and we just keep the commitments around in case. Now, of course, we also need to have an operation to update a counterfactual object in case there is a later state for this object. Then we, of course, also sign a commitment. This time, the commitment is a delegate call, also the registry. And in the registry, there's basically a helper function called proxy call, which just resolves the counterfactual address and then does a real call into the actual update function of the counterfactual object. And we assume that the counterfactual object has an update function which we can use to submit a newer version of the state where everything is checked. And yeah, that's how an update works. Now, of course, we also need to be able to withdraw the assets at the end of the channel, or maybe even in a cooperative way. So once again, we only sign commitments, which we can then redeem in the contract if we want to. So once again, a delegate call is the same proxy construction, but in this sense now it's not a call to the counterfactual object, but this is a delegate call to the counterfactual object. And this is basically what I meant earlier when I said that once you have this mechanism, you can now basically execute arbitrary code in the multisig that's only going to be deployed if necessary. Now, what this basically does is, in the end, it executes within the context of the multisig a withdraw function in the counterfactual object. Now, one interesting thing is, because this code of the counterfactual object is now actually running inside the multisig, we cannot actually access the state of the counterfactual object because we cannot read the storage of another contract. And so to actually get the state, the counterfactual object code has to make a call to the actual counterfactual contract to retrieve the state, because otherwise it's in the wrong execution context. Yeah, so there is an implementation from counterfactual, but the current implementation is based on the paper from where all the graphics and this came from, but it actually differs in quite a few ways, because as it turns out, it's easy to theorize very complicated constructions, but it's much harder to actually implement them into something practical. And so there's also always a difference in the theory and the practical implementations. And so what it does feature though is a global registry for counterfactual addresses. This is basically the same thing as in the concept. And it also has a second registry where the nonces are kept in the finalization status. So it doesn't happen in every counterfactual object. Instead, there's one registry which tracks all the nonces and finalization stuff. And one very nice thing about implementation is it makes a very clean separation of the channel and the application logic. So basically, you can write your application code and not touch any of the channel logic. And that was the whole point between the framework, to make it really easy to implement state channels without having to worry about any of the state channel stuff. Now, how do we implement applications? Basically, applications here are modeled as stateless state transition functions. So you have to implement a function that basically gets the state, you get an action, and it returns a new state. If you have ever done anything with React, you might recognize this as a Redux reducer. One interesting design decision is that the current proof of concept works with turn-based interaction, which means given some state, and it's not actually in second state here, there's always a player which should make the next turn. And the reason why this exists is because then the turn taker can basically continue the state transition on chain in case of a dispute. Because of course in a more complicated state channel, you cannot really know, you cannot guarantee that the latest state update is really a terminal state. Because what do you do if you're like in the middle of a chess game and it hasn't finished yet? You can't pay out anybody because it's still not in a terminal state. And with this turn-based construction, you can complete basically the game on chain. And you can also see who exactly is holding out, because you know who the next player should have been. Yeah, one other thing is also, unlike here, where we delegate code into the counterfactual object and then the code runs to withdraw the funds from the multisig, this does not use delegate call. Instead, the apps basically return a transfer command which states how many Ether or which token should be moved, and then the multisig contract basically interprets the command and executes it. Yeah, so here's this code construction as a graphic. We have our multisig, which is the only thing that you would deploy as a channel. And then there's one global instance also deployed as a conditional transfer, and this is just to outsource some code. So it's basically like code library. And we have, of course, the global registry. There's also the nonce registry, but it's not on the graphic. And then we would have the state channel, which is itself counterfactual, and the app logic, which is also counterfactual. And basically the idea is that the counterfactual state channel would counterfactually run the reducer to compute the state transition from the app logic object, which is of course also counterfactual. And then the multisig via the conditional transfer library would basically query the result from the state channel once instantiated, which returns the resolution, and then the conditional transfer can move the assets out of the multisig as intended. But the important thing here is that if there's no dispute, this part never exists, and we don't never see that there is a state channel, and the application logic also never needs to be deployed. Now we can quickly look at how this looks like. So if we, for example, really quickly look at the registry. The registry is really quite simple. It just has this one function that's important, which is the deploy function. You basically give it the bytecode for the init code. You also give it some sort which kind of identifies the whole thing, so you can have the same object multiple times with the same constructor arguments. And basically it just deploys the contract, and it assigns it a counterfactual address, and then you basically get a resolver function which you can use to actually resolve a counterfactual address into the real Ethereum address on chain. Now the state channel is really where everything happens, but only of course if it's ever instantiated, because ideally it won't. And yeah, so it has the latest nonce, of course. So this is the it actually tracks. It tracks, of course, is it open, is it in dispute, is it closed already. It tracks what was the latest state update that was committed. So it doesn't actually store the state itself, the storage, because it would be expensive. Instead, it only stores a hash of the state. And basically, then you need to submit the state whenever it needs it to compute something. And that way, it saves a lot of gas. It stores who submitted it last. It does, of course, store the last nonce of the state channel, because that's how we detect whether a state update was stale or not. It also has a special nonce for disputes. It has the timeout, which is basically when can the channel be considered finalized if the dependencies are correct. Otherwise, it's quite simple. It has a state set state function, which is basically how you import the state into the channel if you need it, if you want to close it on chain. You submit basically the app state hash, the nonce, and the timeout, which is the structure that's being signed by all the parties. It just verifies that the signatures are correct. Here it has some mechanism for the instant withdrawal. Otherwise, there's a timeout where now the counter evidence can be produced. So there's a great dispute function where you cannot dispute and say there is a later state. So once again, we submit the app state, the nonce, the timeout, and everything we need. And here is basically the check, is the nonce really higher than the nonce we already know, and that's how we know that the previous state was a scale state. And then the turn taker, because it's a turn-based system, the turn taker can now also make a move to advance the state to avoid the stalling. It runs it against the state, so it takes a state, it takes the action and returns a new state. And yeah, that's basically how dispute works. You can also progress the dispute, because now, of course, once the turn has been taken, somebody else needs to take the turn and move it forward until at some point you reach a terminal state on chain. Now, what they also implemented is a cancel dispute. So if everybody signs the latest state once again, you can basically reset the thing. You're back off chain after you have canceled the dispute, in case it was an accidental dispute because, for example, somebody went offline or something. Yeah, so once the channel is closed, the resolution can also get set. It basically gets the resolution, which is how much should be paid from the app logic contract, and it just stores it. And this, of course, only happens after the channel has been closed, which means the timeout already expired. Yeah, so that's basically the state channel. The multisig itself does not really know anything about state channels. It's really just a generic multisig. You will not find any state channel specific code in there. Yeah, so a bit more interesting is the conditional transfer. So at the conditional transfer is, if I quickly go back to keynote, this is this thing here, which is also deployed once onto the chain, and it's basically this kind of library which has the logic to execute the verdict of a state channel once everything has run its course. And then you have this really long function called execute state channel conditional transfer. And this is the thing that you actually sign when you install an app. So when you install an app, what you really sign in this construction is you sign a message for your multisig in which you instruct the multisig to delegate call into this contract and call this function, and that's how you actually install the application. And the idea is, because you have this message in the beginning, you can always then enforce the resolution once everything has been instantiated on chain. And this is the whole finalization tracking. So there's the nonce registry. We verify, has the state channel really finalized at the nonce we expect, because otherwise it's either not finalized yet, or there was a higher nonce and this object was deleted. And then it basically uses the registry to convert the counterfactual address into the real address. It gets the resolution from the state channel contract, and then it executes the terms, which is basically just like an instruction, send ether to this address, send tokens to that address. Basically, this is then what actually sends out the funds at the very end. Now, the actual developer for applications should ideally not have to do anything on this code and leave it unmodified. Instead, the developer basically implements the app interface, and they have a couple of demo apps. Now, the simplest one is probably the commit real app. And so if you develop an application, this is the only contract you write, and you don't touch any of the state channel code. So because this state action-based system, we need to define the actions. So in the beginning, some party needs to set the maximum. So the idea is that this is a guessing game. Somebody commits a number, somebody, the other party guesses it, and if the guess was correct, then the party wins, otherwise the other party wins. That's what's implemented here. So the number of actions, as a set max action, which sets the maximum in the beginning, a choose number action, also by the same party that sets the max. The guess number, which is now the counterparty, which would call this action, and then a real number, once again by the party from the beginning, which committed the number. It is a number of states, so it begins in a setting max state. Once this is done, it goes into the choosing state, then the guessing state, then the revealing state, and afterwards the channel is done. We have two players, we have the choosing player, we have the guessing player, And then we have our application state. And basically we need to store the two addresses of the players. We need to store the state where we are. We need to store the maximum that was submitted into the application. The actual guest number, a hash of the commit, and the player that actually won the whole thing at the end. Now we need to tell to the state channel framework whether a state is terminal, and the only terminal state here is of course a dump state at the very end when the game has completed. We also need to inform the framework who can actually play. If you are in the guessing state, it's the guesser, and in all other stages, it's the choosing player. And then we get to our reducer, which implements the actual application logic. So we see we get the application state and we get an action. And depending on the action, we do different things. For example, if you get the setMax action, we require that we are in the actual setting max state, because once we already have set the maximum, we cannot do this whole the same thing again. Then we will just move to the next state and we set the maximum to the action number. Now, of course, we do a lot of storage writes here, but unless there's a dispute, none of this ever happens, and it's only virtual. Then, of course, we implement the choosing number function. So here we need to be in the choosing state. We move to the guessing state. We store the commit. The guess number function, we change to revealing. We make sure that the guess is smaller than the maximum. Then we in the reveal state, we basically check, does the reveal really match the commit? And then we also verify who actually won. Was it the chosen number or not? And in one scenario, the choosing player wins. In the other scenario, the guessing player wins. And everything else is an invalid transition. And then, of course, we return the new state at the end, because it's a pure function. And yeah, it cannot save the state anywhere, so it needs to return it to the framework. And then we have the resolve function, and the resolve function is basically what's being called by the state channel contract to get the terms object, which determines who should actually get paid. And here it just assembles a very simple transfer basically to the winner with the right amount of Ether. And that's how one would actually implement an application. And as you can see, there's really no state channel logic in there. There's no timeouts. You don't have to worry about nonsense or anything. You only implement those few functions, and the framework takes care of the rest. Okay, so let's look at some alternative implementations. So Counterfactual is not the only party that's working on this. For example, there is Perun. And Perun is another project that's also working on generalized state channels. It works a bit differently. It separates states into substates, which also can be updated independently, but instead of using this nonce mechanism, it's a different way to achieve similar things. It supports virtual channels for non-interactive payment routing. And what this means is that you can basically do the same kind of routing you would do in Lightning, but basically, the hops in between, they only need to approve this once, and then in all their further routing steps, they actually don't need to do anything anymore. That's what's called non-interactive here. So supposedly, it does not support counterfactual instantiation. I say supposedly because I have not checked this. What is great about Perun is that it's developed really by scientists, and it's really done with very rigorous analysis, and they write very detailed papers with formal proofs of everything. And they also got their paper approved to really good conferences and stuff, so it's probably not that bad. There's a much more detailed paper available if you're really interested in Perun. It's quite hard to read because it's really hard, pretty hardcore. Another thing is BankChain. And SpankChain were one of the first, and I think it was the first, let's say one of, because maybe I missed something, but it was probably the first to actually show real code for a counterfactual instantiation based state channel, like half a year ago. Because everything else was only theory, nobody ever actually implemented anything, not even as proof of concept, until SpankChain just did it one day. So it does support counterfactual instantiation. It's not as abstracted as the counterfactual implementation. It's, the code at least used to be quite messy. I think it still is, but I haven't checked. There was no activity in the last 3 months, so I assume that this prototype has been abandoned. I also haven't heard anything regarding the general state channels. But they do use the simple payment channel constructions in production, and that's also interesting because it means they're one of the few companies to actually use channels in production in the main product. Also another framework is Celia, or how it's pronounced. It's also about generalized state channels. It evolved out of a payment channel framework. It has channels with conditional dependence, which I think is similar to the nonce dependencies in counterfactual framework, but it works a bit differently. And they're also working on channel networks, but I think they're mostly focusing on routing payments and not so much on routing like general states, whatever that actually means. So there's also this Trinity thing, which appeared on Reddit a few weeks ago. I don't know much about it. They claim to be a universal off-chain scaling solution. it was pushed into the Ethereum mainnet, so it's actually running a mainnet, not a few days ago, but a few days ago when the presentation was first made. So that was about 3.5 weeks ago then. But it seems to primarily focus on payments and privacy. One interesting thing about this is that it seems to be primarily intended for EOS, but the contracts are all for Ethereum, so I have no idea how this is connected. And they also have their own tokens. I have no idea when you need it. And usually, if you need a token in a state channel framework, it's not a good state channel framework because they added a token where they probably didn't need one. Now, state channels are only a smaller part of a much larger trend. Things are moving generally towards using on-chain only as a matter of last resort. Now, as I mentioned earlier, state channels have very big requirements on when you can actually use them. But for other scenarios, you have of course other options. So other project in the same space is of course Raiden, which also counts kind of like a state channel network, even though a very specialized one. Basically, you only commit when channels actually closed. State channels, ideally they can remain unclosed if there is never a dispute, unless you really need your assets, and then you can just withdraw without closing the channel. KuBit, for example, which is a framework for doing heavy computation off-chain, but being able to verify that it's correct very cheaply in constant time on-chain, also not yet production ready. And then of course you have Plasma and Loom network, which bring entire off-chain blockchains basically. We have entire off-chains, blockchains that basically run off-chain, but in case of a dispute, you can fall back onto the main chain and therefore get your security from there. But yeah, those last three things are not state channels. A lot of people often call them state channels, but state channels have a very clear definition and those are different things. But the great thing about those two is they also work with an open set of participants, whereas those things only work with closed set of participants. So what's actually ready for payment channels? There is MicroRaiden, which is not a network, it's only the normal payment channel, but it can be used in production already if you want to. There are also other payment channel systems like the ones from SpankChain that are actually in production. So payment channels kind of exist. Unfortunately, for generalized state channels, things look differently. There's nothing that's not in prototype status, but at least Perun and Counterfactual have a lot of the concepts worked out, and it's mainly in how they actually implement this in reality rather than the conceptual questions. Now for channel networks, this is a completely under-researched topic, and there are many problems that need to be solved, like what does it actually mean to route in a state channel network? Because in payments it's somewhat clear, but how do you route between chess games, for example? Nobody even knows what it would mean. So yeah, that's definitely under-researched. Now, to help the cause of state channels, since about a week and a half ago, there is now the weekly and the future bi-weekly state channel researchers call, which is live streamed on YouTube. And basically, all the people that are working on state channels basically exchange what they're doing, how they're implementing it, so that we can see what are the differences, so that they can learn from each other. And so far, there have been two episodes. In the first episode, you can get a pretty good overview of what Perun actually is and how it works. Also, Celia has also presented their concept. Also Magmo is this force move thing. It's basically a turn-based structure from the counterfactual contracts that we saw earlier. And I think yesterday there was also episode 2. Counterfactual first of all presented their concept in the beginning. I don't know the rest yet because I haven't listened to it yet, but yeah, it's definitely very interesting material, especially episode 1. It's also quite advanced already, so it assumes that you already know quite a lot of stuff, which is why I would recommend, before listening to this, to actually read the papers, at least the counterfactual one. And yeah, so that's the reading list. If you want a really easy introduction to state channels with lots of graphics and basically explain it like M5, you can read the state channel for dummies, which is really good, which you can find on Medium at this user. Then of course the L4 counterfactual paper, which is great because it really goes into great detail into what can go wrong for most of the paper, and it's a very good foundation to have. And you can of course also try to read the Perun papers, but they are really complicated and full of complicated math and formal proofings. So it's probably the most complicated one. But I think if you've read those two things, you're ready for the researcher's call. And if you've listened to the researcher's call, you can try the Perun papers. Okay, that's it from my side. As Thomas said, I host the Ethereum Vienna Meetups. You can find us on Meetup. We try to have more technical meetups. Sometimes we also have less technical meetups. Our next meetup will be on October 9th with the leader of the Ethereum JS team, which is the JavaScript Ethereum implementation. And yeah, all our slides and materials are usually available also on GitHub in the Ethereum-Vienna-Meetup organization. Sometimes it takes a while until the slides are on there, but they will get on there eventually. Just might take a month or two. Okay, that's it from my side, and thank you for listening.
Punktlandung. So you looked here and basically you decided now it's time to finish.
It was completely unintentional. Exactly, yes.
Like playing. So wow, that was dense. I hope you could all follow. As we already said, we have made a video of this, so you can repeat, sleep, repeat, eat, sleep, repeat. So whatever is needed, how many repetitions? We will also upload the presentation on SlideShare so that you don't have to necessarily go on GitHub. You get it in the next days on the SlideShare as well. Questions. I hope there are a lot of questions. I never assume there are a lot of questions.
Okay. Are there a state channel or payment channel implementation where there are stricter requirements for the nonce numbers? Because right now they just have to be strictly increasing, right?
Increasing. But
yeah,
increase by one.
Do they have to increase by one, or are they usually increasing by one?
They are usually increasing by one.
Or do they have, for example, have to be the...
I mean, the problem is that we don't want to increase by anything other than one, because for example if you sign a new state update with state number 2 and the other party doesn't sign, then you have this issue where if there's a penal system, you can get penalized for honest behavior, which is why you only ever increases by one. You can always increase by 2 every time, but then it's really just the same thing, just with a different number. But it's important to have like a single step that can be identified as a single step, because you need to make sure that you don't penalize if it's only a single step difference.
But there could also be a problem with overflows, right? Because I did not see any check for if
the the nonce is like usually 256. So
I can write the number 2 to the power of 256 and just sign it. So
that's true, but if you increase it only by 1, then you will never get there, because there's no way you're gonna finish and get there before the universe is dead. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a good point.
But if you check that it has to be increasing just by 1, or that it has, for example, to be the current timestamp, let's say the nanosecond since 1st of January 1917.
But it's really not necessary, because the plus 1 already works so well.
Yeah, but there should be some kind of check that you close the channel when the maximum number is reached. So you cannot have
that well, you're never going to reach the maximum number. If you increase by one, it's impossible.
Well, if you increase it by one, but if you really increase it by one.
Yeah, of course, but you would only ever increase it by one because of this discount. If somebody else comes with an already partially signed thing and you see the amount is not plus one, you just don't sign it. You just ignore it.
Would this not sign it, or would it just assume that, oh well, it's larger than the last consent signed anyways?
Well, I mean, this is only the contract code. Signing, of course, happens in some JavaScript code somewhere on the client. But it would, you can assume that the code will only sign it with plus one because.
Well, it's documented behavior and it's pointed out to the developer of the JavaScript itself, right?
Yeah, of course, but that's a programming error and
yeah,
not a design error.
It would help to make it safer. different question. I saw a dispute counter. Does this mean that you can have several disputes? So. Bob puts in something, then Alice has a dispute, then Bob has another dispute.
I think it counts the number of steps that have happened in a dispute so far. So every time that when a dispute first starts, the state channel moves into the dispute state, and so you cannot create a new dispute, but you can progress the dispute because the next turn taker can also make the next turn on chain. And basically, every time such an action occurs, this dispute counter increases. And the reason for this is that you can cancel the disputes later. Because when you cancel a dispute, everybody signs the last valid state and also how many on-chain actions happened in between. Because otherwise you have the problem, you cancel the dispute, you sign it, and then somebody makes, before it gets put onto the blockchain, the cancel transaction, somebody makes another progress dispute. And that way this would invalidate, you use basically these nonce to invalidate the dispute cancel in case somebody else progresses dispute.
Okay, but it's not like ping pong that A can have another dispute again then.
No, there can, there's only ever one dispute going
only
on.
Only one, okay.
So two questions. The first one, this is like a DApp, like a smart contract.
Yeah.
You don't have to like force anything to make like these state channels.
No, it's just a normal contract.
Yeah, and the second question is, would this really help Ethereum to scale? Like, fix the problem, scaling problems?
Well, not alone, but in combination with other things.
Yeah. Sure. So it's part of the solution.
Yeah, of course. But for this end to really work, you need to guarantee that you can get your dispute on chain in time. And for this to, for yourself to guarantee, you basically want a pretty good on chain scalability. So it doesn't solve it on its own, but compared with sharding, it kind of can solve it.
Okay.
What's the usual timeout? I mean, you talked about timeouts a lot, but what's the usual time frame?
Yes, it depends on the application.
Okay.
I mean, it can be chosen.
So you can choose it freely?
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Here the timeout is actually also only constant, but it's part of the signed state. And for example, the way that the corporate withdrawal works is that the latest state is signed at the very end to close the channel, you just sign it with timeout zero, and then it immediately expires. But yeah, I mean, it really depends on the application. If it's like some game where you know that you play and then within the same session it's over, then you don't need to have a long timeout. But if it's like something that's running continuously and you want to make sure that you save, even if you only like every few days, then you're going to have like a week timeout. It really depends. How often do you want to be online and how soon do you want to get the money? And depending on this, you're probably going to choose this.
Yeah. You did mention that there is some kind of random number generation based on state channels. Is there some implementation already open source, or is this close to a scale?
That's only the fanfare thing, which they have explained how it works, but they have not shared the code for this.
And no one did recreate it open
source? I don't think so yet. Okay. Mm. But also because there was a lot of lacking documentation on their part, but they really described the system in a pretty good detail at a conference about 3.5 weeks ago. So, yeah, I guess somebody could do it. But I mean, still you have a random number generated basically on the server at the beginning with like in the new, like from both parties in the kind of like mixed together. Ideally, you want to have other sources of randoms. I mean, this, it all depends on how much do you trust your counterfactual. But hopefully there will be better randomness coming to Ethereum once you get the pkchain and everything, because the pkchain should also be able to kind of act as a source for randomness.
When does this come?
That's an excellent question. it should be in theory the next half week after Constantinople.
Almost
like a year ago, yeah. Anyway. Yes. Okay. Hopefully. Because if it's a delay even this, then it's really a peak.
It's too late to build on something so that's coming in a year.
The beacon chain which comes with Casper,
yeah.
Right? Okay.
And it uses threshold signatures and they can then act as a randomness source. That's kind of the music.
And is there something, a place where you can find out about this random number generation possibilities that are existing now?
Well, in production, it's hard to say. I think most people abandoned the random concept that was that was the idea in the beginning, because it has some flaws and it can always be cheated under some circumstances. Probably, if you have it off-chain and you mix between your own randomness and some server completely off-chain, then maybe you can do it like Funfair did. Otherwise, probably the most cryptographically sound randomness is probably this whole threshold signature thing that's been used in Definity, for example, and then the beacon chain in Ethereum. But it's a really complicated cryptographic construction.
So we heard that basically you said that randomness on chain is kind of not secure, not. So it's really
the thing is that it can always be cheated by miners in some way.
Okay,
that's the problem. If your enemy is a miner, you can't just either if your randomness entropy comes from the blockchain, you can't just manipulate it that way, and otherwise, even if there's something else and the randomness might change over time, then a miner, for example, in the game could just decide mining a block, see what the outcome is. If I don't like the outcome, I just mine another block until I mine a block and get the outcome I want.
Can't you just use a kind of hit and hide and reveal or something like that?
Yes, but that's kind of where the RAMlock concept comes from. And it kind of protects you, but of course it makes things slower, and it also has a problem. You still, if the miner cartel is large enough, you still have the issue.
If what?
If the miner cartel is still enough, you still have the issue. And if the miner is playing, then you still have the problem that the miner could just decide in the losing case or just not continue the game because he knows he's going to lose and he's just never going to send the transaction. A lot of people have tried randomness and there's nothing that really works for us for now, except maybe the threshold signature stuff. But that's so experimental that it's still going to take a while until you can use it.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's definitely an interesting
and
topic.
If you need a lot of random values and you say you use like the last 20 block hashes, not only the last one, then he could only manipulate one and the other 19 already happened.
Yes, but if you combine them, each one of them can arbitrarily change the total thing.
Yeah, but if I use each one to determine one random thing I need, then he can only change the last thing.
That's usually enough.
Yeah.
Yeah,
but
if
you block something, and
if all of this stuff is equal important, then the impact on the total result is maybe not enough to incentivize manipulation.
Depends onto what you're mapping. If you're just mapping onto a coin flip, then again you just depend on one bit. Even if you...
Yeah. No, but if you need a lot of random numbers, and I use a series of 20 block hashes, so he cannot manipulate all 20 block hashes, he can only manipulate the latest one.
If your algorithm is known and he knows the 19, then that's enough to know how to select the last one.
Yeah, but if the last one doesn't affect the other 19s, he can only manipulate the latest.
May I suggest that we stop the random number generation and go on with state channels?
Yeah. Is there any other question that does not concern my knowledge?
Around 2,000 slides before that, how many? So you have the example that two people cooperate on having a multisig.
Yeah.
So what exactly gets published? Is it just the hash of the code that they want to reveal once they disagree or once they want to settle? Or is this code also
in
published?
In the honest code, in the honest example, you would...
So what gets removed?
Question. Can I remove the state channel without... Can I close the state channel without altering? Yeah, of course you can. Yeah, sure. You just need to sign a new message to the multisig where I just transfer out the assets directly.
Yeah.
And then it doesn't matter if the state channel message still exists because there is no assets that I control anymore.
Mm-hmm. But until then, what's actually revealed?
Nothing. Only the multisig is deployed at some point.
So the stuff that's put into the registry can be computed offline.
Yeah. The registry is only ever used in case of dispute.
Okay.
If there's no dispute, the only thing that happens is you have a multisig that is deployed at some point, which you can use for as many channels as you like. And when you want to transfer a value out without the state channel involved, you just make a normal other multisig transaction, but there's no state channel is ever deployed, no application logic is ever deployed, unless there is a dispute.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead, don't be shy. Were you thirsty? That could be also why you're not.
Yeah, and even in a scenario where you close the channel, you don't actually have to withdraw the assets necessarily out of the multisig to make sure the channel is really closed. You just sign a new latest state where there is no more transfer, and you know that in the case that your opponent tries to instantiate the channel, you can always move it to the terminal state and it's done again. So.
Well, terminal state is quite a good keyword.
It puts into the terminal state in the question section, and
then
we move on to the.
Let's keep questions asking at the beer. So I would like to kind of close the session here. And one more thank you to Ralph. Thank you very much.